Hi, morning. Neil Clark, I'm Vice President Education of Glasgow Caledonian University Students Association. So when I was asked a few months ago to deliver a presentation here today on the topic of close working relationships between student associations and unions and IT and other university services, I started thinking about various different technologies, projects and initiatives that could be used as examples. But after checking out the conference and the programme and other speakers, I felt that rather than focus on a specific example of IT enhancing learning and teaching, it may be more productive to take a broader view and look at an example of good practice which kind of foregrounds good student consultation. So quite often on a lot of campuses, the student voice seems to be an afterthought. That's not just a view that I hold, but quite a few colleagues in Scotland and the rest of the UK. So when plans or policies are designed or written, you know, the Students' Association, they're maybe given very little notice to provide feedback before something's approved, whether it's the University Senate or something similar. So it doesn't leave elected officers like myself a lot of time to speak to the wider student body and gather views. So really today I want to use this opportunity to discuss a process of student consultation on a major campus redevelopment project at Glasgow Caledonian, which ultimately aims to enhance the whole student experience and the learning experience. So if you've seen the abstract, a couple of years ago GCU announced a £30 million Heart of Campus redevelopment programme. So a key component of it is an innovative student services space to enhance the student experience. So I'll go on and look at the process and journey of the student consultations throughout the project, but first I'll give you a bit of background. So the last major redevelopment work on the campus was the Salt Tire Centre, which was opened in January 2006. So the building's organised across five floors, there's over 10,000 square metres of space. It took around 3 years to plan and build, cost £23 million including the fit out, and it's won 7 awards for its design since it's been opened. So the name's not just a reference to the Scottish flag. It's pretty clear that higher education likes a good acronym. So SALTIRE actually stands for a building that provides services for students, active approaches to learning and teaching, a 21st century way of managing information, repository of research collections, and engagement of students. So inside the building itself, we've got around 400 PCs, over 1,200 internet-connected study spaces, a 600-seat learning cafe, a library with over 350,000 books and 23,000 journals. There's a laptop borrowing facility, there's about 150 laptops that students can take out for short-term loan while they're on campus, and free Wi-Fi through Eduroam as well. So it's the home to the university library and the base, which is the support services hub, and it's essentially at the heart of the campus. So there's space for students to learn, but there's also space for students to interact. So there's different areas that mean students can take advantage of noisy social interaction areas. So for example, on the second floor, it's kind of group study space. I've been in there myself studying and seen other students with, you know, fish and chips, McDonald's. Not quite seen a deep fried Mars bar yet, but it's Glasgow, so it probably won't take too long. But there's also space to settle down and study on kind of silent study in the upper floors. So one of the upper floors that has PCs, there's a student-led campaign a few years ago that essentially blocked Facebook so that it has genuine individual study upstairs. There's open plan learning spaces. These were designed to be similar to modern office environments, essentially to help prepare students for moving into professional environment after graduation. To me, it's very like a call centre, so it maybe says more about the university's view of graduate prospects once they leave. But last of all, the building is also accessible to all, so it's wheelchair friendly and there's software and technology for students with learning or physical disabilities available in a central location. At the time, the building was one of the most ambitious and innovative learning environments in the UK, so it prompted the Guardian newspaper to describe it as one of the best loved and most used landmark buildings in any UK campus, and it rewrote the design book for academic libraries. The article also goes on to say it's futuristic but people-friendly learning space that's paved the way for universities of tomorrow. Now, before I go into the detail of the student consultation itself, I just want to take a second to kind of put it into context. So a few years ago, the National Union of Students developed a charter on technology in higher education, and they argued that new technologies not only give an opportunity to refresh teaching methods, but also act as a starting point for more flexible, personal and improved learning environments. It also referenced the fact that student expectations are changing, so to respond to this, the modernisation of learning and teaching practices must be a priority for institutions. Not that I need to labour these points too much, given the background of people here at this conference. There was other research by NUS that found that students feel the type of technology used in higher education is increasingly outdated. So this Heart of Campus project kind of gives Glasgow Caledonian an opportunity to address these points, modernise using technology to enhance the learning and teaching. Now, I won't go through the charter point by point, but number 8, which is third from the bottom here, I think is particularly relevant. So, appropriate IT infrastructure needs to be in place to maximise the potential of digital technologies, and also investment in infrastructure has to be a priority to meet the student expectation and demand. So this is particularly relevant to the Heart of Campus project, and I'm happy to say the university did take this research into account at the start of the process. So in terms of what the Heart of Campus project actually is, according to the university PR materials, it's an exciting vision for the future that will enrich the student experience with the creation of state-of-the-art academic teaching and research spaces and inspiring social areas. So from 2014 until 2016, the lower two floors of two buildings, so we've got the George Moore building, which is to the east of the Heart on this graphic, and the Hamish Wood building, which is to the west, they'll be transformed and connected to the centrepiece, which is the Saltire Centre. Saltire Centre is the area to the north of the Heart in the middle. There'll also be outdoor spaces, so there'll be landscape courtyards introduced round about the campus. So the first phase of the development centres on the ground and first floors of the George Moore building, so that's from this year through to the summer of next year. The ground floor is going to be home to the university restaurant and a social learning space, with the first floor dedicated to a new student services area, and that will be located in an easily accessible and highly visible location. When that work's finished, the spotlight will then move to the Hamish Wood ground and first floor. They'll be under construction from summer 2015 through to spring in 2016. So that will feature a glass pavilion at the front of the building, a new gateway for the university, and a clear identity for the Glasgow School for Business and Society. Everything does seem to be led by business schools in higher education these days, so they're going to get a nice fancy shiny front door essentially for their building. That space will also lead to a multi-purpose classrooms and a 500-seat flexible lecture theatre, so you know, exams, graduations, which are currently held off-site, and other events. So here we can see the consultation map. This outlines the different stakeholders involved and the groups that were set up for the consultation. So students here appear outside of the other groups, which caught my eye initially. The Students Associations and myself, other elected officers, were involved in all the different project teams and design groups. But you know, to me initially this struck me as, you know, students have been an afterthought, they've just been stuck on at the side, there's other groups that are being consulted. So the Students Association lobbied successfully, we did end up with more extensive student consultation and more input from the wider student body. Anyone with really good eyesight will maybe see the blogs, which comes up maybe about 1 o'clock on the student circle. That caught my eye as well. A blog's not something I would term as a consultation, a method of consultation. It's very passive, it's fine for communication, but there's not much consultation, I'm just putting information out there. So various different methods were used through the consultation. It wasn't just for students, it was for teaching staff and other stakeholders too. The most substantial of which were polls, interviews and student forums. So this is some of the feedback from a student forum led by the Students Association about a year, 18 months ago. So students didn't just keep their feedback specific to the Heart of Campus project. It was an opportunity for them to give feedback on the wider student experience. So we've got some comments here. GCU should have a pub. We haven't had a bar on campus for a few years. So it's NSS, we get hammered all the time. We've got a bar now, but not at this point. GCU should let me pass my degree. Well, you don't ask, you don't get, I suppose. And also, don't allow Strathclyde students access to the Saltire Centre. Strathclyde's the nearest university to GCU, so there's a lot of rivalry between the sports clubs and other student groups. Thankfully, there were more productive comments during the student forums. We've got comments about bigger computer labs, more social spaces, and that GCU should create a sense of community, which we'll come back to later. So in terms of the polls themselves, this one's about learning spaces, so what type of study spaces are missing, places to meet and gather, places for events, what kind of individual space do you need. It's a kind of even split between screen space, large layout tables and soft furniture for power and data transmission. In terms of group spaces, almost three quarters favoured both formal and informal, so it was like fully equipped closed spaces and flexible spaces as well for group study. This poll is focusing on technology, so in terms of the types of technology that students use or carry daily, it's quite an even split between different platforms. This was, like I say, about a year and a half ago, so I'd be interested to see the results of this was repeated, because I think there's a lot of movement in terms of the devices students are using. For the websites and applications that students use for study, social media came through as a clear preference. I'm a bit of an optimist, I like to believe Facebook's used for group study, but I'm sure a lot of members of staff would disagree with me. In terms of how easy it is to find information about the university, vast majority, 80%, found it very or moderately easy. Another question, it was a bit of a horizon scanning question, what tools do you think students will predominantly use in the near future? So internet and social media space were joint highest with simulation. I think the simulation reflects the high number of health and life sciences students we have on campus. The nursing programmes get the highest intake of all undergraduate programmes. There's a new clinical simulation ward or lab, so that feels quite highly. If anyone watches Waterloo Road in the BBC, any time any characters are in hospital, that's filmed in a clinical simulation lab at GCU. Another interesting one for me, but it's probably the mature student in me coming out, traditional media was not far behind social media and other types. In terms of communication, ease of navigation around the campus, almost all found it very or moderately easy. I think that reflects the geography of the campus. For a city centre campus is quite compact, it's only a few, four or five buildings. In terms of the current signs and wayfinding systems, a significant minority, almost 30%, found it unsatisfactory or poor. So that was then built into the heart of campus process going forward. For the last of the polls, community, how can a Heart of Campus project assist in building a sense of community? The strongest preference was to develop facilities and activities that will draw people onto campus, but at the same time encourage others to stay. Again, I think that's a result of us being a commuter campus. The vast majority of the students live within an hour of the university or the city centre of Glasgow. There were also strong preferences for spaces that encourage interaction and develop more or better informal social spaces. I think that reflects the feedback from other polls. Last one was how would you describe the university identity? All encouraging responses, so students feel the campus is fun and modern, friendly and welcoming, and open and accessible. So at this point I just want to take a second to highlight the importance of community. Like I say, we're a city centre commuter campus, so we do find it hard to keep students on campus outside of timetable classes. So we're always trying to foster that sense of community in the students, not just from the Students' Association perspective, but an institution as well. So this quote from Oblinger's book, Learning Spaces, says, all aspects of education should acknowledge community. So just as a learning paradigm focuses on the importance of learning, they argue for a community paradigm emphasising the role of social interactions in facilitating learning and improving student engagement. So through community, learning can grow. So in this chapter they go on to argue that research and learning theory, how the brain works, collaborative learning and student engagement has taught us that people learn best in community. So fostering that community is critical to learning regardless of whether an institution is online, commuter or residential. So they go on and say that a focus on community and community building and seeking out ways in which community can enhance learning can be done in three strategic ways. So that's about improving the process of developing learning spaces, using information technology to enhance communication and collaboration, and about using community to improve pedagogical, curricular and co-curricular environments. I think these are particularly relevant to the Heart of Campus project, and even more so given that the university introduced a new learning, teaching and assessment strategy last year. And from conversations I've had with the PDC Learning and Teaching, I think it's clear the university do see a direct link between the learning and teaching strategy and the Heart of Campus project. I think I would agree you have to get the environment right for students to come in and engage in the learning and teaching at the university. So this graphic shows it's a learning and teaching workshop map. So some of these were led by the Students' Association, others were led by external consultants involving members of staff. Without getting into too much detail, there's quite a lot up there. We see community down the bottom, it's linked to both equipment and space. And equipment and space, both of elements that are linked to collaboration and contemplation. I think that reflects the student feedback regarding preferences for group and individual spaces and methods of study. And this is some of the feedback about the workshops focusing on space that's been collated. So comments relate to empowering space, flexible spaces and group spaces, including play areas. So again, the optimist in me likes to think that's come from student parents and not from a student that wants a soft play area to go and chill out in after a lecture. So once the consultation processes were complete, we moved on to the design phase. Maybe I'd argue it's still in the design phase, even though construction started, but I'm sure the university would disagree with me. So there's a lot of different project boards and workshop sessions that continued after the consultation process. So the main challenge here was ensuring that all the different groups and boards were communicating with each other. It was a continuous challenge ensuring the student voice was at the top of the agenda at every meeting. We were talking about phasing the construction, so the logic was we'll knock down walls and do the major work in August because there's no students on campus, so don't come back till September. But there's an exam reset date in August, so it wouldn't be the best if there's walls getting knocked down when students are in sitting exams. So the key point for me in the Students' Association was basically to ensure that any potential disruption was minimised and making sure there was a clear communication strategy so that the wider student body were kept informed and updated. You see here one of the plans. This is for the administration and learning and teaching space of the Hamish Wood building, focusing on learning spaces in AV and IT. So like I say, there's extensive Students' Association involvement during the design phase through the workshops, project boards and project teams. The project board and all the groups were really receptive to student feedback, including elected officers like myself having quite a major say in the design of a lot of the areas. It wasn't always easy, and one of the meetings my colleague Vice President of Wellbeing or Welfare had proposed the introduction of gender neutral toilets. And spending £30 million redeveloping the campus, it's an ideal opportunity. She basically got laughed out of the meeting the first time she suggested it. So for us that was about lobbying the university and raising awareness. We were successful, so now all buildings are going to have gender neutral toilets, not just the two that are part of this project. Another area we had really extensive input to was the new student services area. So it's formally known as the Heart of Campus Central Service Zone. So it's a student services area that's going to utilise a one-stop shop approach. So we're going to have things like registry, careers, the funding team, international office, and positive living and disability all in the same space. The Students' Association will have a space too. We're still kind of thrashing out ideas of what kind of format that's going to take. The area will also feature an accredited customer service team, so there's consideration being given at the moment to the interactions with students, so whether that's like a triage or roving support. There'll be a combination of open, semi-private and private spaces in this area, and we've also lobbied for a bank of trained students to kind of staff these areas outside the traditional hours. On campus we've got quite a successful student mentoring programme where students are paid to mentor students in the years below. So kind of based on that model, we've got buy-in from the university to have students in this space out of the kind of traditional 9 to 5 hours or whenever it's going to be staffed. And the last phase is construction, so a lot of preparatory work has been ongoing for the last few months. The major works are due to commence in the next few weeks. Key concern from the Student Association, from my perspective, is to minimise the disruptions throughout the whole construction phase. We're going to have students that join us in September, and for at least half of their time at the university, there's going to be a building site at some point or some area of the uni. So it's really important we keep up to a lobby in the university to get the communications out there, the information. And as well, like with exam diets and reset diets, and just keeping on top of that. I've got no doubt, though, that there'd be a lot more disruption to students if it hadn't been such a good partnership approach between the Students' Association and the university itself. So we've essentially kind of opened it up to the wider student body and let them have a say in the process. And the last slide, this is an artist's impression of the front of one of the buildings. So this is what it's about like. Hopefully there's like a cyclist about to go through a glass window, if you see that on the right hand side. Now I know the next speaker coming up is going to talk about how to be radical, but to me student consultation and things like this isn't a radical idea. If it's done properly, I can guarantee that effective and meaningful consultation does lead to improved student satisfaction. There'll be a positive impact on the student experience, including progression, retention and success. Before I finish, is Alistair Reid Pearson in here from Huddersfield? Likes a blog. Has anyone else seen the blog about Step It Up? Good, so I'm going to plagiarise it at the end. Alistair talks about historically having a process of just updating the student union with upcoming projects. I've never really worked collaboratively on anything, so when I did decide to work collaboratively, the initiatives that came to life in a way they could never have imagined. So they didn't step it up, they did a slam dunk at the end. So I think the point I want to get across is, you know, everyone's got a Students' Association or Student Union, so use them. They can help you to step up your ideas, as Alistair says, and it could be the bit of the jigsaw that's been missing all along. So thanks very much for listening. Any questions?
Hi, David Johnson, University of Western Scotland. You were talking earlier on about community and how it helps with the learning and stuff like that as well, and I agree totally with you. But your university is very similar to our own, and the fact that you were saying there about students commuting, but also the fact of the matter is that most students have a job. Yeah. So how do we keep them on campus?
Yeah, that's another good point. There's some research at GCU a couple of years ago, and I think it was about half of our students work. And I think it was over three quarters of the students who work between 20 and 25 hours a week, which is a lot of hours when you've got your degree to work on. It is hard, you know, through the Students' Association, we do a lot of activities. We're trying to do them during the timetable, from Monday to Friday, 9 till 4 or 10 till 4, whatever it is. So it's about just having different activities that people can engage in and not expecting people to come in at 5 o'clock on a Tuesday night for a meeting, because people can't do that. And you know, if there's maybe more important meetings and events on, then you know, run it once or twice through the week at different times and give people an opportunity to come in, because once they're on campus, if you can keep them on the campus, that's the best way of kind of building that sense of community.
One of the things with that is there's now a push for using social media, using tutorials, lectures online, stuff like that as well. Is that not a contradiction?
Well, I think the lectures online, I'm really interested in that idea, you know, the kind of flipped classroom, so that when the students are getting the contact time as usual, so they'll have the lecture online, but that lecture, you know, students do that in their own time, or when they're on the campus and they've got a computer, but there's still got to be that guaranteed contact time. But I think it is quite a challenge to kind of juggle all these things. It's the name for the kind of disability and student support parts. It's Positive Living and Disability Service. So it's getting quite a lot of referrals for mental health. Is becoming quite a big issue in education. So, you know, I think their waiting list Well, the NHS waiting list in Glasgow is like 3 months or 4 months. The positive living, it's 3 or 4 weeks. So they do a lot of stuff around mental health and support that way.
Any other questions? Right, brilliant. Thank you very much.
Thank you.